Independent Drivers Association. For those of you that are not familiar with OOIDA, we are an advocacy group, a trade association for owner-operators, small business truckers, and professional truck drivers. We have a little over 162,000 members in the United States, a few scattered up in Canada as well. Small business is sort of the key thread of our membership, but our core membership are going to be big rig, long haul, mom and pop trucking operations. The vast majority of them who just have one truck in their fleet. They will serve as the company owner, as the CFO, as the freight manager, as the safety director, and as the dispatcher, and in many cases as the sole driving employee for the company. And those folks, our membership, folks like our membership, make up a very large portion of the trucking industry in the United States. But why don't we start off with doing some introductions. Pete?
I'm Pete Emahiser. I've got 20 years in freight brokerage, the last eight of which is owner-operator of Tadmore Transportation in Toledo, Ohio. Number 980 in the Inc. 5000 fastest-growing companies list last year. Also a moderator of a Facebook group, Rate for Mile Masters, very active online, helping out the little guys do their thing. And besides that, I'm a pretty boring dude.
I'm Kenny Long, and I'm an addict. But seriously, I'm addicted to helping other people. I own a small trucking company, Patriot Star. My wife and I run it. We've got about 20 owner-operator trucks now. We also just recently started a brokerage. We're in our second year with the brokerage. I also run a training company called You Drive You to help owner-operators progress in their business and grow and understand the numbers and learn how to be successful.
Good afternoon. My name is Chad Boblett. I did 10 years in the Marine Corps, and after the Marine Corps, I started driving a truck as a company driver for 4 years, and then I became an owner-operator, bought my own truck with four credit cards before making money at all. And 4 years ago, I started the Facebook group called Rate for Mile Masters. A lot of people know me from that group. It's probably one of the largest moderated professional Facebook groups oriented for brokers and carriers and owner-operators.
How many followers do you
have? We have in the Facebook group, there's I think 23. We're up to 23,000. We're very strict on letting people in. It's probably 30 to 40% are brokers and agents, and the other half of the other percent would be made up of owner operators and carriers.
Kenny, you produce podcasts. What sort of following do you have?
There's been times when I have 30,000 downloads in a day. It's the Trucking with Authority podcast, again, to teach people to learn to move from driver to owner-operator to becoming a small micro-carrier of their own.
Great. Well, you know, the title of our panel is How Technology is Affecting and Enabling the Micro-Carrier. So I want to break that down a little bit and then sort of really dig into it. When you hear micro-carrier, I think of small business, and most folks know, a lot of people, though, that aren't in the supply chain world or familiar with trucking really understand how significant small businesses are to not only the trucking industry in the United States, but certainly to the entire supply chain. I'll give you a few quick statistics from, and this is according to the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration. So fleets of 20 or fewer trucks comprise 96% of the interstate motor carriers in the United States. They also represent somewhere in the ballpark of 40% of the freight hauling capacity in the U.S. trucking industry. Go take it a step further. Fleets with six or fewer trucks represent about 84% of the trucking companies, the interstate trucking companies in the United States. One step further, fleets with just one truck, motor carriers with just one truck in their fleet, represent about 49% of motor carriers that are registered to have interstate operating authority in the United States. So the trucking industry is very much a small business industry. And those numbers don't even account for all the owner owner-operators that act as an independent contractor with another motor carrier. A good example would be Kenny. He has 20 owner-operators that are leased onto him. Sort of on the other end of the spectrum would be a Landstar. Landstar is considered an asset-light transportation company. They have over 9,000 trucks that are going down the road pulling their freight. They don't own any of them. All of those trucks are going to be owner-operators that, again, are leased on to Landstar and serve an independent contractor relationship with Landstar. So that's sort of the micro carrier side of it. And the other piece is technology. You know, as we talked before and as we thought about it, technology is, you know, covers a lot of different territory, whether you're talking about gizmos and gadgets or software or what have you. So I think what we're going to do is I'm going to toss a few bombs in the middle here and sort of see where they take us. We already started to talk a little bit about social media and how that has served. And maybe that's a good place to start. Maybe Pete or Chad, if you want to tell us a little bit more about the Facebook group that you guys have.
Well, again, the name of the Facebook group that I started 4 years ago is Rate Per Mile Masters. I created it for it. I'm a rates geek. I love talking to people about rates and one of the things that I know that when I went from company driver to a carrier, I never did the owner operator thing. The difference in the amount of money you make versus a company driver being a carrier was just blew me away. So I love talking to the people that were interested in getting their authority and making that step. So that was the interest of creating that group. And there's been countless of great things that's come from that. I would say every month millions of dollars are traded hands in the networking that takes place within the group. Whereas I, as a carrier, will network with a broker as Pete as such, and instead of resulting to a load board to find loads, Pete knows me and he knows if I'm in that area, he can we'll talk and be able to get the load from each other. I've seen many times where we'll know if fraud is going on. A most recent scenario happened where someone was imitating, they were impersonating a broker and a carrier, and to get money from a broker, and we were able to get the word out. One of the silent members in the group messaged me and said, "Hey, I got this boy. You need to listen to this message." And it was a recording where he recorded the person that was trying to scam him. Well, if it wasn't for the group, he would have fell into that trap. So that's helped out. It's helped out the little guy with the social media. It's helped out a lot of people getting their taking that next step and getting their authority. There's a lot of misunderstanding about getting their authority, like it's a hard process and that you got to have your own customers. I wrote about the myths. DAT blog. I do a lot of DAT blog. I'm a blog contributor, and I wrote about the myths. Anyway, those myths. I try to let people know it's not that big of a thing. You can keep yourself employed off of the load board, and that's one of the things we do in the group is help these guys out. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say that to go off that we have the big group where everybody works together. Of course, we kind of got knowing rates and lanes. Every kind of contributes in. Shane is a moderator in both groups. These guys been around forever and ever, helps a lot of people. For us, it's been very good for us because we've been able to utilize and meet a lot of good carriers. And brokers, believe it or not, have a bad name. And on Facebook, we're able to see somebody, you know, hey, you connect with them at a human level. And we have a private group we have for this, our Tadmore Transportation, open loads. These guys we've met primarily through Facebook. And I would almost say we could probably cover 80% of our freight through people we met on Facebook. So not only did I have friends before Facebook, I didn't have
friends. Right, and I would think that in the course of those conversations, that's a time that it's shared about the people testing out different technologies, different apps, and what have you.
Yes, Chad mentioned the call recorder. We have an ACR that we promote in the group. One of us started using. I'm not sure who it was first. And everybody, they call it the Reaper Mile Master car. It's just kind of, you know, it's a great thing.
Well, and you just mentioned Shane, and I know, Kenny, we were talking earlier, speaking of technology,
right?
And networking, sort of building off the network, about you just recently went through a process of researching, looking into perhaps testing out some different transportation management systems.
Yeah, with 20 trucks, we find ourselves caught between a rock and a hard place when it comes to that level of technology. Because you have the Landstars that have the 9,000 trucks, they have proprietary software that they've partnered with and they've spent millions of dollars to develop. Then you have a lot of companies that specialize in the 1 to 5 truck, maybe, range, but that software is very limited on what it can do. Once you break above the 5 trucks, you have to start working about, you know, driver settlements, payroll, maintenance reports, tracking IFTA miles, things like that. The software options become very limited for the money. And so I tried several systems. I used some of the lower-end systems, used a lot of workarounds, and what ends up happening is you get multiple little systems that, you know, you log into multiple systems every day to do different tasks every day, and it becomes very tedious, a lot of double, triple entry for a lot of different things that should be simple. And, you know, working with some of the bigger fleets that have the software in place, it's a one-click operation to what takes us several steps. Granted, they have to click it 9,000 times for what they're doing, but it still becomes very tedious and time-consuming, and you don't have the revenue stream to support office staff and things like that, so this software becomes very important. We ended up, you know, some of the bigger ones quoted me nearly $100,000 to bring in a system. Others quoted, and they flat told me, oh, great, you'd be perfect. We work with startup companies, no problem, $5,000 a month. And I'm thinking, you and I are on a different page. You know, that doesn't work for us. So I ended up spending close to $20,000 for a system, and I have 20 trucks. Most people that have 20 trucks can't afford a system that way. This was, you know, me thinking that I will eventually have a lot more than that. I need to plan for the future, but I know that is a huge outlay of cash for a company my size.
So what did you did find?
I did.
Or are you still kind of...
Well, I'm in the transition right now. I did find a system. Of course, right now, everything, they're pushing to go cloud-based, and, you know, the systems that are cloud-based are lacking with different options that you can have and different plugins and features that you can use. So I ended up going with a site-based system, which has limitations of its own. You know, here I am in Atlanta. It's very difficult for me to log in, you know, remotely to a site-based system. You know, there's workarounds for that as well, but there's still not the perfect solution out there. You know, I found the best solution for me at this time, which hopefully 3 to 5 years, you know, there'll be another better solution. But right now, and I look even out, you know, the sponsors that showed up here, we had multiple different TMS systems. None of them work together. Most of, you know, every booth out there has their own software to solve their own specific problem, but currently, none of them work together. And that, to me, is the biggest hurdle in front of us, trying to overcome that barrier. I think that's where blockchain will come in, to try to give a uniform, you know, data method to where all these systems can be on one platform and easily integrate with each other. That's what I hope in the future.
And obviously,
you're talking about the micro carrier. We're a startup. The first thing that killed us, cradle-grave software, we still struggle across the board. You have all of these top-down companies, these big software companies, looking at the name of their shirt. And you got all the other operators looking at the hole it needs dug. And the big companies need to quit looking at what's on their shirt and look at what needs to be dug, you know, you can grab a shovel. And the industry, in my opinion, will not progress until I mentioned a couple guys I met about doing a share, but just give it away to the trucker. How many truckers can save 80%, 90% of this? So, you know, we can make 10% as efficient as we want, but until we help the little guy become more efficient, the cost will override any sort of savings you can save in your own fleet.
I think that's one of the things that we've found out, and I can tell you, because of folks wanting access to our membership or wanting to learn from us, I get phone calls literally weekly from some new software provider. Many times it's folks that don't have an in-depth understanding of the trucking industry. So I can sniff it out pretty quickly in the conversations that where their understanding of the trucking industry comes from the mega carriers that make up less than 1% of the companies in the trucking industry. And all too often, I think that's a hole that some software providers fall into. They bring on consultants that had worked for a large motor carrier, or that's the folks that they're reaching out to, and the misunderstanding is that for a large motor carrier, nothing against large motor carriers, but they do make up a tiny fraction of the overall industry, but their daily reality, how they deal with freight, how they deal with drivers, their needs is going to be dramatically different than Pete's or Kenny's or certainly Chad's, and these are the folks that really represent the people that are moving the majority of the freight out there, and certainly the majority of the trucks out there. So, yeah, let me toss a word out to you all and whoever wants to sort of chip in on this, because it's kind of a buzz term in the trucking world, the supply chain world these days, but that's freight visibility. What does that mean to you? And what is that connecting that with any sort of technology that's currently out there that you're utilizing or you're aware of, or that you're aware of and seems promising associated with freight visibility?
I'll tell you if you guys don't want to. We have literally an opaque surface in front of us, and I apologize for using words I shouldn't use. But there's a huge difference between knowing when your neighbor goes to work and knowing which bedroom your neighbor sleeps in. When you look through the windows, when you're paying attention. Freight visibility, we have a long way to go. And unfortunately or fortunately, that driver, he still does things that he may or may not want people to know. He may stop off at maybe the guy likes kiwi, and he wants to stop off at a kiwi store. He doesn't want people to know he's stopping for kiwi. So he doesn't want to be tracked at all minutes of all days, all times. And I was talking to a gentleman in the audience Ed yesterday about this. If it was me, and we want a freight visibility, the driver doesn't care if you're tracking or not until he gets into the dock. And we talked about this. First Choice Hair's Cutter, I don't have hair, but they have the ability to sign an online, and you can have an appointment waiting for you when you get there. You can be in line the whole time you're going to the store. And I don't understand why we don't adapt that to trucking. I mean, a haircut's an inconvenience. Trucking is $700 billion a year. But yet we have a driver pull up in front, walks in, and takes him 10 minutes to figure out who he is, and attending the dock. It's just ludicrous to me. But I think visibility, we need it. But what we're fighting against, the shipper wants 100% visibility, and the driver wants 20% visibility, and there's got to be a medium in the middle.
Well, I can go off of that as well. You know, you mentioned the majority of trucks out there on the road are the 20 or less carriers. If you were in the big room the other day when the rep from C.A. Robinson was on there, he can track exactly what product is in what box, on what pallet, in which truck, on what boat, right to the point that he was on stage and the delivery guy practically set it in his hands when he walked up there. That is impressive. Microcarriers do not have anything like that for the reason I just mentioned before. There's a lot of products that would like to be a plug-in to a bigger platform that would allow that. But none of them work together yet. So the microcarriers don't have that. Now, the C.H. Robinson is I think, the biggest, one, you know, in the top three biggest brokers in the world. And, you know, they have that ability when they put their freight on our truck to know what they're doing, and they have their own plugins of, you know, MacroPoint or their own, you know, apps and things that they require. But at this smaller carrier, you know, microcarrier level, it's just very, very difficult because the expense to develop that type of a system is just out of reach. The technology is there, and the technology is not that expensive individually, but they don't communicate with each other. And if we could just get past that, now we are almost all using it. We all now, due to federal law, nearly every truck on the road has an ELD device, has the telematics. We were out there checking out the sonar, freight wave sonar earlier. It's amazing the technology that they have, that they can track exactly where trucks are, how long they sit at the dock, all that stuff. And that's from that ELD telematics and the technology that most of the trucks have now. All the microcarriers have it as well. But what do you do with that information? You have to have a platform to plug it into. And so the freight visibility, the capabilities are there. We just need something to translate that data.
Freight visibility, transparency with freight visibility. Since I've had my authority for over 7 years, all of 100% of my freight has come from technology, the load board, which is this year is 40 years, same age as I am. It's been around, same technology. You're using the phone dial a truck, DAT dial a truck. It's the technology that I'm using it. This industry is so slow with coming out with new technology that works. Here's what, going into the future with how I get my freight, you know, like, so for 7 years I've been using the load board, getting my freight off the load board. I would like to go from not using the phone. Everybody's texting. If I build a relationship with an agent, all of my movement of their loads from then on, once I have their cell phone, is all done through the cell phone, texting. There's no reason to be making the phone calls all the time or picking up the phone. So I would like to see that in the future, to go from the phone system to the texting or some type of chat where I can chat back and forth. And here's something else the two largest load boards, their goal is to how many loads that they can put on the load board. And then even brokers, their thing is, well, we want to put on the load board as many loads as we can. Well, that's not the goal that they should be going for. I don't want to read or see ghost loads or loads that don't even exist. You know, I want those loads to be offered to me. Hey, these loads are yours, and I don't have to make a phone call. I can put in my price, and they can say yes or no to a click on it. That's where I hope in the future we get away from the phone and we get away from just accepting the load. If you see what Uber is doing, Uber Freight, if you see what Convoy is doing, that's the type of technology that I want more to happen in the future. Where we don't have to do code negotiate anything. We can do it all online. So freight visibility, I can talk about that good stuff all day long, but I hope the load board becomes smarter in that area.
Well, because you went there with Convoy and Uber Freight, and we're on stage with two individuals that are in the brokering business, I'm just curious, Pete, Kenny, what are your thoughts on, because that is a big thing, the digital, you know, I just walked out a little while ago from the big room where it was the digitalization of freight, and that is a big thing that's coming on. From my standpoint, I'll lead into this a little bit. From my standpoint, and I've been around trucking for a while, I'm skeptical on how this plays out. And it's nothing against folks from Convoy or Uber Freight, and we've had many conversations with some of their folks. They seem to be trying to do the right thing in certain aspects when it comes to owner-operators. But I've seen this for a long time. How long have we looked at, literally since the internet really became accessible to most Americans, somebody has been putting a load board on there that's a no-fee load board that's supposed to be, take the middleman out of it, right? That the freight is going to be there, and the carriers are going to be there, and it's a platform, and it's going to be awesome and wonderful, and everybody's going to make lots of money. I've seen that over and over again, and it never plays itself out. Part of it's a chicken and egg sort of thing. You need the trucks to attract the freight. You need the freight to attract the trucks. That's part of it. But there's many more pieces that come into play when it comes to serving as a transportation intermediary. OOIDA at times has been a loggerhead with certain brokers, but brokers, 3PLs, transportation intermediaries, however you want to refer to them as, serve a very important role. So, with all that said, again, Uber Freight, Convoy, there's a few others out there. From a broker standpoint, from a small broker standpoint, how do you see those folks playing out? Or that technology being embraced by the wider trucking population?
Well, I can start with that. I'm a fairly new broker. I've been a trucker and a carrier for over 20 years. But I've only been a broker for about a year and a half. And my whole perspective of this industry was turned upside down when I started calling other carriers. because just like the guy flipping burgers at McDonald's think he's the best burger flipper in the world, he deserves $15 an hour, every truck driver has that same mentality. Every truck driver thinks they are perfect, they know exactly what they're doing, and, you know, I felt the same way. You know, nobody can deliver freight the way I can, and everybody must be like me. I mean, everybody must be able to jump back to the dock, you close the doors, you deliver the freight and everything else, until you start talking to others. Everybody's got their own way of doing things, and things fall apart. Matter of fact, Elizabeth just made it here because one of our customers had an emergency. She had to literally leave here. One of our trucks was passing through town. She literally had to run and hand them keys just in time as he was passing through Atlanta to go save the day because one of our customers dropped the ball, forgot to tell us about a shipment that they need out of Orlando right now. You know, and he knew about this months ago. That kind of stuff can't get fixed with an app. There's always going to be a human element that requires more than just an app can handle. Even like Chad was saying, I know Chad is a big advocate for that, but I don't want a point-and-click negotiation. I think that's the one place where the small carrier can still have a competitive advantage over the big guy is because we're able to be flexible enough to solve those problems. And if it's a point-and-click transaction, it's a point-and-click type load where it's, you know, dock-to-dock, warehouse-to-warehouse. If it's a point-and-click load, it's also going to be point-and-click prices, point-and-click rates, point-and-click problems. I want bigger problems to solve. And, you know, when I do other coaching outside of trucking as well, and, you know, just a mindset change, you know, overcoming problems is what helps us grow, and it's what helps your business grow as well. So what you should always be looking for is not the easiest solution, but the next biggest problem that you can solve. So the app is an easy solution to an easy problem, but the loads that I want to specialize in are the ones that an app won't solve.
I have way varied opinions on this. The example I always use to try to explain to people is, your son's getting married, he wants to know what it's like, so you tell him about your honeymoon. The app only concentrates on the moment that you make the deal. I'm not sure where it has a deal, where the background is, it's price. And I've never seen an app with a gut feeling. And the only reason that I'm halfway good at my job is because I can read people either through the phone or in person. I'm able to establish trust. An app is a great idea when you have an abundance of trucks. But what happens when there's not enough trucks? Just to decide that to act. And now we go into an auction, and now your freight rate is dependent on somebody else who's using the app. I mean, you sell bricks for a living, he sells Rolls Royce, so he's going to win. You know, so you get to disappoint your customer. I mean, it's a great idea if you have a market where there is an abundance of trucks. But if you fall into a situation where you have an abundance of freight, which is where I think we're heading to, I think the app's gonna fall flat on its face before it even. I tried to go downtown in Toledo on 10th Street. I tried to go six blocks. It was wintertime. They wanted $20 on an Uber. They haven't figured out the rates. And if they can figure out the rates without surge pricing, I mean, can you imagine going to your customer and saying, "I'm sorry, sir, there was surge pricing with a 2.5 time hit because it was raining, and there was a ball game."
That'd be fantastic.
That'd be right.
Just to continue on with it, my thought, and I didn't say it earlier, but my thinking is, and I said this, you know, the load boards and the brokers, everybody's all about when they use the load board, and it's about which load, even drivers, when you talk to drivers, which load board has the most loads. I don't care about which load board has the most loads. I'm back to the, you know, the ghost load, there's ghost loads, you know, there's one load board that you can normally search back. That the lowest amount of time is 2 hours. They want you to see all the loads they have. I don't want to see 2 hours. I want to see what's been happening in the last 30 minutes. I'm not calling on a load past 30 minutes. Here's my thing, to go along with what people are talking about. My thinking is, now, what if Pete has his own people, you know, his own group of carriers that he's worked with, that he trusts, that he knows. Instead of, Pete doesn't want to throw out his load, his one load that's with his special customer to 300 drivers that's in the area. He wants to first only show it to Chad Boblett and these other people over here that's done work with him that he knows. And that's where the point and click comes into play. And I guarantee Pete could send me an email, same thing as what would be on the load board, and if I took it, he wouldn't even have to talk about it. He would automatically give it to me. months of it was free.
I'm not trying to sound braggadocious. It was just after Christmas time this year, Ryan Brunswick, he calls me on the 27th or 28th or something, huge snowstorm upstate New York. He says, hey, we got a bunch of snow. I said, oh, I heard about that. He says, hey, dude, there's like three trucks and it's 2,000 loads and 50 miles. Do you need my truck before I go start looking? And I didn't know there was a problem out there. I said, you know what, let me call the customer. I said, and we happen to have something coming up. But that relationship is what gives you the truck first. It gives you the phone call. You know what I mean? It's not, and we can get, I mean, I say we can get trucks cheaper than anybody else because we pay for our fair market price. But they don't even treat her with respect. We have good dispatch. And all of that falls into the relationship. And I'm not sure how fast we go from, you know, human to, I don't know how fast it goes.
Maybe we're on to something here, though, that we can, somebody can develop some software or an app that can be customized and used by smaller brokers to within their preferred network of carriers.
Well, I think DAT would be they're the largest, and I don't know if I would mention that. They are the largest, and most people use them, but I think they would be the perfect company to release something like that. Because here's the thing, at this show, we see all these great companies come out with their great ideas and displaying what they got going on. I love that creativity. I'm all about creativity. I love reading about it, seeing it. The problem is I've been doing this, and I go to Matt's, it happens in Louisville. I live 85 miles from there. I've been going there since my dad took me there when I was a kid. The thing that, the pattern that I see with that new technology, is just it never seems to get off the ground. Like you might see it this year, you might see it next year. When's the last time you've seen a truck or path at Matt's, you know? You know, at one time, they were the biggest, and everybody was thinking, oh, this is going to be the next big thing. Well, they were, you know, for a couple of years, and then they were gone. DAT would be a great candidate for that, in my opinion.
Well, let's talk about that a little bit, because DAT is the largest load board provider of, I don't know how else you want to refer to it, truck or freight market platform, if you will, but DAT also, because of their load boards and the information that's gathered from posting those, as well as various other things that are tied to it, they are a very large data provider for the trucking industry, for brokers, for carriers, for shippers and receivers, for that matter, as well. You mentioned Sonar, which is obviously a new product by our good friends from FreightWaves. In effect, that's data, that's information that's being made available, that's being aggregated, that's being cleaned up, that's being presented in a certain way. How do you utilize in your own operations, whether it's DAT or the potential for Sonar or somebody else, how do you utilize data like that? Because, let me preface it with one more statement. Because one of the things we've seen, and I've heard from folks, the transportation intermediaries, had a long conversation with a good friend of mine the other day, and he was talking about how in his 20 years in trucking, and they deal primarily with small carriers, the folks he talks to, the carriers he talks to, are so much more sophisticated in their understanding, and they're asking much more specific questions about freight and about loads than they once did. Now, that's not everybody. That's not all truckers. That's not all the motor carriers. But the folks, at least, that they're dealing with. And you would think that comes from much more availability of that information. So, again, with DAT, Sonar, what have you, how do you utilize that sort of data in your operations?
Reviews. Reviews, DAT has come out with reviews. I think maybe they might be going on in the fourth year that they've had it. They had the review section part of it where you can review. I almost can read the reviews without even looking at the credit score. I can read the reviews and determine whether I'm going to work with the broker or not. That has been by far the best thing that I treasured the most about DAT was those reviews. Being able to read the reviews and see the experience that someone else has had with that broker. And it saved me. That someone wrote a review, I didn't get paid attention, and on a place that they were picking up with a broker out of Dallas, and even the person in the review talked about the place that they didn't get paid attention, and they ended up sitting there for 5 or 6 hours. Well, I called the broker up immediately while he was in the process of sending me the rate sheet, and I'm like, hey, I just read a review that people are not getting paid attention at this location. He's like, no, we don't pay detention at that place. And I'm like, all right, I'm out. You know, detention's a big issue for me. I don't want to be a part of that. And so it saved me that those aspects. Reviews have been the best thing ever. If just like Amazon, would you go buy something? Would you buy a pair of shoes from Amazon that only had 2 stars? No, you want to buy something that's got 5 stars. I hope in the future, that's the next thing I'm hoping for in the future, that I can select. I just want to see 4 stars or above brokers. I don't want to see nothing but 3 stars below. You know, I'm hoping that that's what we get in the future. I mean, that to me replaces the transport-based division.
I can add to that. Most small carriers look at the load board and they say it's a list of loads. And I tell every owner-operator that I sit down with, and we, you know, onboarding, bring them on with me, I provide the DAT load board, and that's the first thing they click on, is the list of loads. I said, that is the least valuable part of the tools I'm giving you. I'm giving you the most expensive version of this so that you have all the other tools. And it's all of the rate information, the lane information, the, you know, the hot markets, inbound, outbound ratios, everything else that you can find, that you need to look at all of that stuff before you even consider looking at the loads. Because if you don't know what the market looks like, you can't give a competitive price on a load. You don't know what kind of prices you'll be getting into and out of certain markets. And I was drooling over that sonar stuff. I mean, it's still kind of beta testing, but the potentials for what they have out there are phenomenal. And they said they have some kind of inner workings possibly with DAT in the future. Those two tools combined, I mean, it's unreal. You know, and matter of fact, while we were out there sitting on the couch, you know, before we came into the event here, I was asking about a couple of specific lanes, and they're able to look at how many, you know, trucks are in and out of certain areas. Because on one of my Facebook groups, I had somebody ask a question about why are rates, you know, compared, you know, from Ohio to New Jersey different than they were, and, you know, going back to trends and things. And without that information, you can't tell. But in just a few minutes, you know, just looking at some maps and things out there, you can just, a world of information, you know exactly how and why, you know, the prices are the way they are. But there are so many carriers out there that don't have that information. And unfortunately, the biggest problem, competitive-wise, you know, on the carrier side is you're competing with other carriers that don't know any better. And, you know, in the broker side as well, you know, when I call on the truck, I've absolutely, you know, had to post a load on DAT's board, and I will get drivers that call and say, I'm calling about a load from point A to point B. Don't ask any details whatsoever about the load, and they just throw out a price. And I'm at that point practically ready to hang up, because if they don't care about the specifics of the load and about taking care of my customer, I don't care about them taking my load. I'll go find somebody that pays attention to these things. So then that information, all that stuff is there and available.
How about you?
Technology we use, Carrier 411 is a huge, huge one. The reviews.
What is it? So Carrier 411, what is?
Carrier 411 is basically you can type in an EMC that verifies that they are active, how long they've had their authority. If the telephone, the name, the telephone number, the address, the fax number, the email address have been used in conjunction with a different company, it will flag that and tell you. You can Google a picture of what the guy's office looks like. But most importantly, like the reviews, it allows the brokers to leave, we call them freight cards, if somebody held a load hostage, and we almost got, not almost got caught, we have safeguards in place. We had somebody a couple weeks ago trying to scam us on one. We were able to